Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. It is my proud privilege today to invite Professor Avinash Nivrutti Supe to our next session on Chat with the Legends. We've really had some legendary surgeons, starting from Professor Palanivelu, Professor Wadia, Professor Nageshwar Reddy, Dr. G.V. Rao, Dr. Shrikhande, and today none other than Professor Avinash Nivrutti Supe. Sir has been a mentor to me. Of all the legends I've interviewed, I've always admired them from a distance. And this is one man who I've seen right from the first day of my house job in surgery till today, till when I built my new hospital. Sir has been coming to see the hospital from the first lab to the eighth lab, and he has been mentoring me, guiding me, correcting me, and I hope you'll continue to do that in the years to come. Sir, thank you for
definitely. Oh, such a pleasure.
We'll start, sir, with your childhood, and I believe that your father was a government servant in Nagpur till he first shifted to Mumbai in 1980 when you were 4 years old. Tell us your time when they first came to Cotton Green. Your early life was in a chawl. Tell us a little bit about that life, sir.
See, my father was a stenographer in the beginning, and then when the Maharashtra government reorganized in 1956, my father came to Cotton Green Charles, and we were stayed there for 4 years, and that time I was hardly 1 to 4 years, and that is not something which many people remember. But what I remember is in 1960s we shifted to Government Colony, and Government Colony had its own environment. It is again one room kitchen kind of an scenario. Most of the people were clerks or superintendents, that kind of an scenario. And we were mainly from Vidarbha, and we came to Mumbai, and that Mumbai was a totally different culture for our family.
Sir, and you grew up with 4 sisters at that time.
Yes.
And in a small room in very Cotton Green, and then to...
Yes.
So,
most of us at that time used to spend our time outside in the chowk where we used to play. Whenever we wanted to study, we had to go on the terrace, and or sometimes when there was a lot of heat, we used to go below the tank and we used to really study there for our standards. And that was a kind of an system there it was, and that's the way we grew up there.
Sir, I believe from nursery to third standard you went to the municipal school.
There.
Sir, I believe from nursery to third standard you went to the municipal school in the Government Colony, is that right?
Yes, there were 5 children studying at one time, and it was not so easy for everyone to pay for that. And that's
the
reason,
private
school that time. And that is the reason why I was in municipal school for the first few years.
Great.
And after the third standard, I shifted to the private school, which is that time there was a scheme. If there are more than 3 children, then the 2 children get off.
So you are one of the
Yes.
So,
teen pedo free it was. And that was one of the wonderful system that time was with Shirsekar sir and Chindarkar sir. And then it was a transform from the municipal school to the Mahatma Gandhi school. And I spent 4 to 6 into that school.
So, there will be a lot of young surgeons from medical colleges across the country watching this video. And I hope they will be as inspired and motivated as I am from listening to how, sir, you have come from a municipal school to the famer institute of the US, to probably a pinnacle of glory that a surgeon could achieve. Sir, there is a story, I was reading a little bit about you, and the story about a teacher of yours called Kamal Joshi, who actually came home to find out why you
sure.
weren't coming to school.
Yeah, I think though these schools were very small and new, the teacher-student relationship was very great. Even if I don't come for a day, I think they would come and see me whether I'm sick. They will see to it that I was acting. Once I had some, mumps or something like that. So she came to see me and see that I'm getting well.
Amazing.
And I still had a connection with her for till almost many years.
Amazing teacher. I'm sure you're an amazing student for her to come and do that. And then 6th standard, you shifted to, you know, at that time, one of the most famous schools in Mumbai, which is Parle Turk Vidyalaya in Parla East.
Sure. I think one of the, I don't know in the 6th standard how much maturity you have, but at that time I realized, though I was always used to stand first in my class and everything was fine, the school was very close, but suddenly I realized that no, I need to go to little higher school. And I really had that time fought with my father. That time my 2-3 sisters had passed SSC, so our burden was there, my father had got promotion. So then he decided to put me into a big school. I told him I want to go to Big Sill, I wanted to go to Pune also. But my uncle was there. But then my father said, you want to be in Mumbai. And then very classic example that you don't want to go towards the flow, you go against the flow. And therefore, he put me into Parle Tilak school. And I think it was a major decision in my life. But I feel looking back, the school really makes a change. The Parle Tilak Vidyalaya was a big school. There were 9 divisions and there were many sharp students there. Wonderful libraries, wonderful science laboratories, much better than even many colleges have today. And that really changed the way you looked at the school. Our school was not only teaching facilities, but they used to have a lot of other things, like simple thing I'll tell you, how to really reflect. One of the things they said that in the 9th or 10th standard, everybody had to read and present the editorial or one of the way what you have understood from that newspaper. I think one when starts reading an editorial of a newspaper, I think everybody realizes what is the real crux of the science. And that at a school level was a great thing
also
for us.
A school with great Marathi Asmita and
yes,
discipline.
Everything. Tilak and that was the Golden Jubilee and wonderful teachers. I mean, this is a teacher where there used to be all merit holders and I was in one class, which was supposed to be one of the best classes.
A division they used to call all the best
one student. And that is what, 10, 11, 11, 1. So, and I had wonderful teachers, Kugo Apte, Neera Sahasrabuddhe, Watve Madam. And these are all national award winning teachers.
I also read a statement attributed to you saying, enjoy the game, never get disheartened by failure.
Yes, I think
sure you have your share of failures in life.
Yeah, many.
I think many young kids today, I look at my own children and they're not used to failure. They get things very easily in life.
Absolutely. I mean, this is the first thing we were taught in the school, not only in Mahatma Vidyaminder, but also in Parle Tilak. Even if you fail, just go ahead. I think failures are bound to be part of your life. You are not going to succeed all the time. You are going to fail, and if you are ready for that failures in the beginning of your life, I'm sure you can take anything later, because life is full of failures in the beginning, and of course you excel later.
Failures can happen even later in life, so why early? Really?
Of course. So, any stage of life.
That's right. So then after this, you obviously got an admission on merit to St. G.S. Medical College, K.M. Hospital, which was like creme de la creme. I'm a proud alma mater. So I think you went, and I believe your inspiration was your mama, your maternal
yeah.
uncle.
I think there was a very interesting story. When I was in first year science, I appeared for the IIT exam. And I came 10th in the India. And that was something which everybody was saying, you have to take IIT admission. But then my uncle was a doctor and my uncle's family, whole everybody was doctor. So I wanted to be a doctor. So I left that admission and I went to InterScience that time. InterScience also I appeared for IIT as well as the MBBS. Both times I got admission into IIT. But then I decided to go to GS Medical College and I think that was a life-changing time.
So what tilted you? It was only your mama saying this. What were your parents saying to you?
Parents were probably not very sure. My father once discussed with me in first year science that if you're getting IIT and you're leaving that, it's a big decision. Then I probably that time told him, no, I want to be a doctor. Maybe I never realized the importance that time, that how big risk I was taking. But I think we all take risks.
And God so, has been extraordinarily kind.
Yes.
To you, sir. I imagine
your
history would have been different.
Yes,
if,
exactly.
If Dr. Avinash Suppe had been an IIT engineer.
Sure, I would have been US somewhere. Because all my classmates went
actually,
to US.
Probably was IIT than US.
Yes.
So then things really were very, very interesting in MBA. You met your future wife,
yes.
Dr. Swati Suppe. So when was that? First time this? When did the courtship begin, sir?
I think we
I'm
knew.
It. Some personal questions. So
sure,
me.
No problem. We actually, I had a typical medical college romance. And first year, I knew her. But second MBBS when we, yeah, you know, my medical college like KEM has a wonderful kattas, which are stone wall building. And we used to sit and that and study together pharmacology, I remember. And that's the time I think we started courting. And then we courted for almost 7 years before we got married.
So romance or pharmacology?
And And exactly. And I think it was a library and the campus and whole college knew what we are. And I think now also people must be remembering our romance in college.
Great.
And that's the way we grew.
Any problems with either family about you getting together? I'm sure
not,
it used to be a big issue.
Yes.
Marriage was
yes. Problem. I think there were of course concerns because I had three sisters who were dwarf and that's the reason my mother had some concerns.
Yes.
But you know the way we are dominant, and then we told her that I'm going to marry, so later on there was no issue. And Swati is a very nice girl.
And so. Madam's maiden name was Mangaonkar.
Yes.
From their side, they had any problems?
Not really.
You were okay.
In the after my past MBBS, till I think probably till MBBS we never told anybody, but after MBBS we slowly told, but then they said you wait till MS, so we all wrap it after.
So you got married after you finished post-graduation. Sir, we are now going to play a video by Super Madam, and she give you some insights into sir's personality that many people don't know.
Oh my god.
Hi everybody. I know my husband, Dr. Avinash Supe, since we entered GS Medical College as batchmates. The few main things I noticed in him as a classmate were his enthusiasm, hardworking, helping nature, being friendly with everybody, and his other extracurricular activities he used to be engrossed into. Education wise, I have seen him, the amount of work he used to put in for everything, be it a MS degree, hospital administration or education management. As a dean of both Sion Hospital and KM Hospital for 5 years, he was very modest, down to earth, easily approachable and was always helpful to people. I have seen him going out of the way to help people, be it paying the fees of needy students, giving money to his poor patients to buy medicines, also going so far as donating the entire prize money of his Best Teacher Award.
Sir, interesting video that we saw.
Yes.
Madam says that you are calm and mentally balanced.
Mm.
Not many wives in this planet will say that about us. My wife should think he's got one screw. So this is exceptional. But I think it is something maybe to do with Madam rather than you.
Maybe.
She,
maybe.
I think, is a great follower of Brahma Vidya. And she is actually an instructor for Brahma Vidya.
Sure.
So tell us. Was it marriage that led to Brahma Vidya or the other way around?
See, I think we have been knowing each other now for more than say 45 years. And I started courting somewhere in 1976, so it's 44 years we have been courting. So of course, during that time, everybody understands. I'm sure we had initial some disagreements and fights. But one good thing happened to her because my wife started working with Brahma Vidya for last 15 years. And after that, I don't think we have any major fights. It's a quite calm life. And maybe I also matured over a period of time. So maybe that's
so
all it is.
So you don't agree that it was your marriage that forced her into Brahma Vidya? She had to calm herself down.
No.
So another interesting madam tells you about something. We always know you even as a surgeon. You know, my first hydroseal in my first house post, first week was assisted by sir when he was reader at that time, associate professor as we call it. And I've never seen you angry, flustered. But madam gives us some instances, things that anger you. And especially when you are seeing that somebody has got a job or a position when he didn't deserve it. Tell us that facet. I've never seen that facet.
No, I never show my disagreement or anger like that, I personally feel. But, you know, especially when you're working in a public institution with there are so many people around you, there are so many things happen which probably you don't mentally agree. And when we are brought up in a merit-based system where we feel that the merit should delegate the advantage, sometimes people try their pulls or people try some other things. I think that time if they excel and some merit student doesn't get that, deserves what he gets, it is little back of your mind, you feel little upset.
So in spite of that, you not only survived, but you prospered as a dean of KM and SAC. We'll come to that in a little bit of time. So after finishing your final MBBS, why did you choose general surgery?
I think before going into MBBS exam, I was really impressed by my teacher, like Dr. Samsi and Dr. C.V. Patel, Dr. Bhale Rao that time, but more by Dr. Samsi. And in fact, I was lucky to have him as my teacher for this third term, third MBBS internship. And in fact, in internship, I started attending his OTs, and he used to also his wait. My first hydroseal, like I assisted you, Dr. Samsi assisted me my first hydroseal when I was an intern. And then I had decided, yes, I have to be general surgeon. And me and Rajan, probably both of us had decided that we'll become surgeon.
And Rajan that sir is alluding to is Professor Rajan Badave, who was the director of Tata Memorial Hospital, who was sir's very close friend and surgical colleague during his initial journey in his KM times. And we'll now hear a short video from Professor Rajan Badave.
It is a pleasure to share what I feel and what I have experienced with Dr. Avinash Suppe. Dr. Suppe epitomizes the finesse and the quickness of Dr. Ravi Bapat as far as surgery is concerned, and the empathy that Dr. Samsi epitomized. I can't forget years and years of outpatient in Dr. Samsi's unit, the OPD getting over by about 2:33, and then coming back for a round in the ward, all of us terribly hungry, and he would bend down right next to the patient with Dr. Suppe right next to him and asking him, "Shira khashil?" And I used to stand behind and say, "Me khain." I would eat that. But that empathy is there with Avinash. And I don't think we would have been where we are both together had we not shared the great bhendechi bhaji in his dabba and pineapple souffle in my dabba. It is with this that we have grown, and 2 months of study together for MS General Surgery is what has made both of us what we are today, and I cherish these memories always. Thank you, Avi.
Great. Interesting to hear Professor Badave's comments of studying MS over Tumchi Bhendichi Bhaji and Maza Pani. It's a, you know,
I think video. I must
sir
tell you,
beautifully.
Yeah, I personally feel Rajan is such a intelligent and excellent surgeon, and we both learned together. In fact, I remember, I must tell you this story very clearly, and I have told it few times before also. It was MS examination when I was appearing. I think I realized somewhere in the month of July, and my exam was in October, that my preparation is okay, its theory is not so strong, and that is what, because I had worked 4 posts at that time. So Rajan and me decided that okay, we will go to Cooper Hospital. That time he was a registrar in Cooper Hospital. So both of us went to the 4th floor of Cooper Hostel, and our day was like we divided Love & Belly book into say 30 day chapters. There were 60 chapters, so we said 2 chapters every day. Morning 6 o'clock to 11 o'clock we used to read those chapters. 11 to 12 was lunch. And from 12 o'clock to night 12 o'clock, both of us used to just discuss cases, how will you write questions, theory and everything. After 30 days, we realized that we are going to pass without any help.
Fantastic.
And I think that kind of an peer learning, that is the message everybody I would like to take key. Many times teachers do influence you, but more influence is by your good peers, your good friends. And many of your friends, if you are very close to them, they will help you. And there should not be any competition. You each other help so much that both of us can grow. And that's the way to really live.
And I'm sure there'll be a lot of young surgeons, residents listening to this interview. And I hope my own children, Advaita and Amrita, are listening to this. And that's a, you know, eye-opener about how you can be during a medical career and your residency. Sir, if I were to ask you, if there is one teacher in KM who I would ask you, tell me who inspired you the most in surgical training?
I think definitely I have to say Dr. Bapat in my initial career and Dr. Samsi in my initial career and Dr. Bapat in my later career.
Sir, and Dr. Badve has made an interesting comment saying Avi has the surgical skill of Dr. Bapat and the compassion of Dr. Samsi.
Oh, that fine.
That is such a unique thing.
I think that's a wonderful
that's
comment.
That's a great compliment, sir.
Yeah.
I have worked with both of these individuals. I was Dr. Samsi's PG student. And I've seen sir sitting by the bedside of a patient holding his hand. And I've seen that in you as well. So tell us, after you passed MS.
I must tell you one more thing. I think here I learned three things from three people. The academics and approach to the science by Dr. Mathur and Dr. Naik. Skills by Dr. Bapat. And compassionate and communication skills from Dr. Samsi.
Amazing. So
I think
just to tell you the audience about these individuals, Dr. Subhash Naik was professor of gastroenterology in KM. Dr. S.K. Mathur, also one of my favorite teachers, was professor of surgery. In fact, when sir was lecturer, Dr. Mathur was reader in the same unit. And I was the houseman, very small man in that unit at that time. And I saw all these great stalwarts above me with the unit headed by Dr. Samsi. And Dr. Bapat used to, in his own words, say, Maji Sonyachi Bhota, the great skill of Dr. Bapat. I'm sure
sir
will be able to interview at some point. I'm
sure.
Have a hearty laugh when he hears
this. Yeah, definitely.
So what was your time as a lecturer, sir? When you finished MS, where did you go? What were your choices? You never thought a super specialty and going out of KU?
No, I got twice admission into plastic surgery. I did one post in pediatric and one in plastic. And both of them wanted me to go back department. That time, super specialty had no... I mean, used to get admissions very easily for a KM student. Twice my name was listed for MCH plastic surgery. But somewhere other, the general surgeons at that time convinced me that he remain with me, especially Dr. Samsi, and they called me that, yes, you have to be there. That time was a time when general surgery was changing. That was a time when endoscopies were coming in a big way. And after 5-6 years, then the laparoscopies came in a big way. And that completely changed the structure of general surgery and GI surgery. And Dr. Nayak that time introduced to us to GI whole fatality. I think that made me leave. And one of the best part that time was when I joined Dr. Samsi's unit, Dr. Samsi told me, Avinash, whatever you want to do, you do, I am going to stand behind. And he never interfered into the unit for almost 7-8 years. He used to just come every day, advise me, but the whole unit, I had such a freedom in that unit. And then you feel like staying, then you are developing wonderful people, and that was a unit. And our unit, I must tell you, had a reputation where we used to get toppers. And of course, Dr. Roy is also one of the topper he joined. But if you look at my all registrars over the last so many years, they were all toppers. And to work with toppers who are going to be leaders of tomorrow, excellent, intelligent people, I think it's itself is an charm, and that's really pulled me into this.
Sir, the system in our time was different. Dr. A.B. Samsi was professor in head of department, so he would get the student, he was first on the merit list. And life in those days was very simple. You were first in third MBBS in your college, you got the HOD's unit. So obviously, as sir said, top of the list would go to Samsi sir's unit.
And that is the one thing which made me really work, because you're working with excellent people, you're doing wonderful surgery, then you don't really bother about the other aspects of life.
So if I were to ask you about any of your students who you have memorable memories about, I'm sure there are lots of them, but can you name two or three people who specifically you really feel very proud about?
Oh, I have, if you really say, I have so many proud.
Three students that you could tell me about. I think it's a difficult choice.
Yes, I can, I mean, looking at you, definitely.
No, sir, not me.
Oh, there are practically all my registrars are working today on top of the world. I mean, really look, I mean, if you really see in US, Chirag has become now head of the transplant unit. Then if you see Abhizar is working into NHS, then if you really look, Nilesh is working in Just Look. Then if you look on the other side, Singapore, I have my surgeons, Australia, all of the world surgeons are there.
I'm very happy to hear that. Sir, why did you choose to remain in full-time? Because, you know, you were such a good surgeon, you had developed great rapport with people. You became lecturer, then reader, then professor. Many years in your formative years spent, because I think you had learned all you had to learn by the time you were a reader.
Sure.
Why did you decide not to go into the big bad world of practice and remain full-time?
We had a lot of discussion in our family before this, and I remember if you have to go as a surgeon and either you have to build a new hospital or you have to go and hop up into different hospitals, you know. And one of the thing is we had no definitely any kind of an having a new hospital was out of question. I could have gone into practice and earned money, but then the other side is me and Swati had a very good understanding. I think Swati, my wife, went into general practice in 1981, and then money was not a major problem, and we had enough money. I'm not saying we had a huge amount of money.
It's also a simple. I don't think people will say the same thing. Do you think Madam sacrificed to some extent to become a family physician so that you could continue as a full timer?
Her father was a general practitioner. Okay. And she got actually MD degree, but then she decided that I'll do one medicine post, one pediatric post, one skin post, and I'll go into practice. And that was her decision. I would have loved her to become a specialist and be a lecturer, and then we would have been happy. But this decision really helped me to stay on for a little longer. Because, and then let me tell you, after my decision and my success, there are many others who took this decision. If you look at then Dr. Bapat, Dr. Dalvi, most of them, one of them went into practice and one of them into, and our careers flourished and no issues about it.
Let's at this point, ladies and gentlemen, play to you a video by one of Sir's students and successors in KM. Also my batchmate and close friend, Dr. Chetan Kantharia, who is currently professor and head of surgical gastroenterology at the GS Medical College. Let's hear his video about Sir.
I feel very humbled to speak on my teacher, Dr. Avinash Supe, referred by all as Supe Sir. To speak on Supe Sir for few minutes only is at the risk of doing a gross injustice to a towering personality like his, studded with laurels, achievements and accolades. There is every chance of missing out on something. I have had a unique opportunity of knowing Sir as an undergraduate student when he was a lecturer with Dr. Samsi, as a resident when he was the unit chief, and as a colleague when he was my professor and head of the department, and finally as an employee when he was dean and director of our institute. He has not only been my teacher, but has also been a teacher to my wife, my brother, my sister-in-law, and also my son. He is one of the finest teachers who has a great passion for teaching. The packed MLT auditorium when he used to take a class is a testimony to his popularity as teacher. I am sure he must be one proud teacher to have his students doing very well and occupying position of prestige not only in India but across the globe. Apart from being an excellent teacher who has a great passion for teaching, he is an academician to the core, a very good, skillful and safe surgeon, and also an able administrator. In spite of all his achievements, Sir is a very down-to-earth and a humble individual who addresses everybody either as beta or tai. He loves taking out his residents for a treat every 3 to 4 months, though he himself is not a foodie. Of the various qualities he possesses, the quality I am envious and would want to imbibe is his farsightedness. The way he sets his goals and goes about working towards it successfully, and his ability to multitask efficiently. Thank you.
Thank you, Chetan, for your wonderful testimonial. So coming on to your time when you decided to go from general surgery to surgical gastroenterology. That was a new department. Dr. Bapat, it was Dr. Bapat's brainchild in KM. And there was a lot of resistance from general surgeons.
Yeah.
What can we do that those guys can't? I have heard this dialogue when I was in KM at the time.
Yeah, true, very true. I think that was a time when actually the whole thing started somewhere in 84, 85. when we started going to these GI surgery meetings, and that was a time when we realized that this is much bigger than what we want to really do and what we are doing. That time we were not doing any major surgeries, so many, except for portal hypertension. We were not doing too many levers, we were not doing Whipples, we were not doing. So that was the time we started doing these surgeries, and then realized that we need a dedicated time, we need dedicated wards. And it happened that after 15 years of struggle, I was put into that department when Dr. Bapat became vice chancellor. And that was a department where there was nothing. In that department, there were only beds and there was no tea, there was no lights. And I was given that department, and the whole hospital and the whole community was watching what is going to happen to this department. They'll close after a few days and they'll come back to general surgery. There was a lot of resistance from everyone, and
very time that was, you know, general surgery in KM was at its peak.
Yes.
They were the first guys to do ERCPs, the first department to do endoscopy, sclerotherapy.
And laparoscopy.
Yes, laparoscopy, Abhay and J.P. Started laparoscopy there.
Sure.
Dr. Mathur started sclerotherapy, shunts. So it was a quite a well-known general surgery.
Yeah, so and I was also part of the whole thing, and but still, I realized that yes, there is a need for a separate department, because I personally feel that unless you separate out your own field and focus your work, now that's a message I want to give it to everyone, because you cannot do everything. As a surgeon, even if you are a general surgeon or even you are a GI surgeon, you have to focus yourself to a particular area. And I thought this will not happen unless you create your own department in a hospital like ours. And if you really look at the history, look at Chennai, you know, people did the same thing. If you look at Delhi, you know, Dr. Nandi did the same thing. Dr. Rangamasham did the same thing. So I just followed their footsteps.
And they have produced a generation of GI surgeons
exactly
across the country who are now at the leading part. Yeah. I remember one dialogue, sir. I brought sir to show him this Zen hospital plot. And after having seen everything, he asked me, kiti loan ghetla hai, you know, in Marathi language, how much loan have you taken? And I said, be careful ki tu administrator hot nahis. Means in English to say that, remember that you are primarily a surgeon, not an administrator. And this is what sir has reinforced, that pick up a specialty, remain focused on it, and make sure that your financial or social pressures don't deviate you away from your
absolutely core specialty. Absolutely.
So you then went into teaching. Your big love was teaching, and many of us are avid teachers, but you actually went to do a master's at the University of Illinois in 2008.
You're a
hardcore surgeon.
Yes, I remember this in 1993. Before that, I attended one course in Jipmer. That was, I think, Pragna Pai madam was there, our dean, and she said that we have to really start one medical education unit. And this was something, a new thing, and nobody knew exactly how do you want to take it forward. So we went for a 10-day course, and that really changed my whole life. I think I realized it, ki there is so much into this science of social sciences, which is going to help and make our whole profession little better profession, better students, and what I was doing, we need to really change. And then opportunities came over a period of time. I got into MUHS, various academic activities. Then FAMER came, and FAMER was one of the very good opportunity where I got one of the 11 people selected in the world.
Tell us more about FAMER, sir. Not many people in this country know about a FAMER fellowship,
okay,
or FAMER Institute.
Many of the people know ECFMG,
yes,
because people have been appearing for USMLE, and they developed a foundation called Foundation in Advancement in Medical Education and Research. This was formed somewhere in 2000, and they started this FAMER fellowship. So what their whole idea was, that you select people from the world, about 11 people or 12 people in a year, you train them intensively for 2 sessions in 2 years. And it was a wonderfully developed program. It was something like a leadership program. You not only teach them leadership, you teach them the science of education, and you also teach them educational research. And the whole idea is that you go back and you develop the whole thing back into your own country and your institution. I think this was a concept which I picked up, not only for the education, but also for the hepatobiliary surgery. I was very fortunate to learn from Professor Blumgart, the person also who has made a lot of impact on me, because he was the one who used to teach me one by one, explain every operation, every patient, what is a disease. Very few people get that opportunity for 6 months. And
talking of Blumgart, he had come to England when I was training there, and his first slide in the oration was, a jaundiced lady with a subcostal scar, a midline scar, a paramedian scar, a horizontal scar, and he just had the letters TBB put. And he started the oration by saying, "This is a typical Bloomgaard patient. I do not operate on the virgin biliary."
Yes. And
I've never forgotten those words in my life.
You know, and it was an experience where he used to get patients from all over the world, and he used to analyze them, and he used to say that, okay, this is a patient, I'm going to operate this way. And next day, he would like to do that operation exactly as he used to call as advertised, you know. And, you know, it was his style. So, Famer really helped me to bring this concept. And I had a wonderful time with Famer. Then they took me there as a global faculty. And then I went into, I tried to change the whole faculty development program in the country by developing the first regional institute, which was very successful. And then we developed the medical councils program, and now it has been taken over by the National Medical Commission. And if you really see in last 15 years, we have now developed more than 45 to 50,000 teachers who have undergone basic course. And I think medical education, along with the surgical education, I feel has been the wave. The same was when we tried to do for the IHPBM. If you really see what I learned from Professor Bloomgaard, I think Professor Jagannath and I could really develop the IHPB in such a way, not only the beginning just do conferences, but later on take this hepatobiliary to the mid-level cities, small level cities. So now you see, after 20 years, we have lot of VIPULs done in mid-level cities, hepatectomies are being done, HPB surgery, the way it is done laparoscopically and open, has now changed what it was 20 years ago. And I think
the outreach program in Bhutan, Nepal, yeah, all over the South,
yes,
East, at least. Sir, you had many awards, the BC Roy Award, the National Board of Education awardee, your Anbai Award for medical teacher, you also MMC awardee. If I ask you, which of these awards means the most to you?
I believe in Dr. Bapat's philosophy. You know, awards mean to me, but I think patient satisfaction mean to me more.
Right.
When I see a patient who goes home happily and blesses you, I think that is more award for me. I mean, I would put all these awards into my drawer, but patients' blessings would be on top of
me.
Fantastic. And I think I always feel awards will come, but what is more important is how much goodwill, how much of happiness you create in patients. I will tell you a story about this, you know. There was one Adivasi girl, you know, she was about 14, 15. I remember that time we were not doing advanced laparoscopic surgery. And she came with a colorectal cyst. She had an inflammation, so we advised her that you will require to undergo an open surgery. Her family said, "Ki doctor, hey, operation kele tar maza lagna honar nahi." That means if I do operation by an open operation, I will not get married because nobody will marry me. Then we waited for 1 year. After 1 or 2 years, when we started doing laparoscopic, we did her laparoscopic colorectal cyst excision. I must tell you, the most happy point for me was when next year she came with a baby in her hand. And I think, and she, I think that kind of a happiness you can ever imagine with any kinds of awards. Of course, awards are good for improving motivation, giving you little amount of enthusiasm, but more important is to, I feel, the patient satisfaction.
Absolutely. And this is what in Marathi we call punyai, punyacha tarazu.
Yeah.
So, I then think you made probably one of the, to me, the controversial move from becoming a surgeon to becoming an administrator. And I remember having told you, sir, what are you doing to me? Sir then became the Dean of St. G.S. Medical College in KM Hospital. Having reached the pinnacle of surgical success as professor of surgery first and then professor and head of surgical gastroenterology. From, I remember that building, in the new building there was an empty ward, nothing there. And later in about 3 or 4 years, it was one of the best equipped OTs doing fabulous complex GI surgery. And suddenly I hear that sir is now becoming Dean of GS Medical and he's going to become administrator. What was the trigger point?
Okay, fine. I think that's a very good question. I really, we've changed from a small ward to doing a liver transplant program. And when I, that kind of a level of expertise and level of working which started working, and I thought that was something which you reach at the pinnacle. I think any surgeon who has up to capability of the liver resections and transplant, I think is the good level of the expertise. And then when you grow in a system like this, there are two things happen. One is, if you don't grow, the people below you suffer. That is one aspect you should always remember. And secondly, when you go at a higher level, you can do good for many more than what you are doing now. When you are a surgeon, you are doing only one person's happiness, you know, I mean, you are saying. But when you become a dean, probably if you are a sensible person, then probably you can do lot good into the system. And that is what I realized when I was, that time I was growing in education, I was growing as a surgeon, I was growing, I had also that love because I had done Tata Institute and I was a teacher for masters in hospital administration for many years now. Then I realized that this is a time when you have to make impact into an organization which has given you so much for 35 years. And I think that institution which has built me, I must really do something for that institution. And therefore I wanted to come back as a dean. And in a small way, I could contribute to my organization, whatever it was. I understand it is a little tricky decision from living, but I never left my surgical knowledge. I used to go and operate in between at least once a month, and I still do it also occasionally.
If I were to ask you, sir, what were your successes as a dean? If you look back at your time as Dean GS Medical College in KM Hospital, and then Director of Medical Education also, what would you tell me as your pinnacle of success?
Okay, fine, sure. I think the success of a deanship is to bring lot of development. What I could do really is bring lot of development at both the KEM level, outside level. If you really see today and look back last 5 years, 7 years, we have got lot of new things, like we have got new equipment, new services. Look at the stroke service, cardiology services. And all those were started during that, and that spread across all over the medical colleges. Secondly, there was a need for development in the city for building good level of public hospitals into the secondary sector. And if you see today, there are 5 or 6 hospitals renovation and the new buildings are coming. And that was all effort of our work. There were a lot of programs at the public health level we did.
If I were to ask you, what were your failures as Dean?
Oh,
so I'm
going
to ask you difficult questions also, sir.
Yes, the failures are many, as I said. I think failures as a dean, because you cannot do something which you want to really do. Like, as I said, many times academics, I tried to push academics from KEM. Normally, say AIIMS has about 1400 papers and KEM has about 350 to 400 papers. I wanted to bring that to little higher level. Some way or other, I could not bring it from 300 to 350, but I could not take it to 500.
Why and that was happen?
Because I think there are many people, commitment sometimes for academics is poor.
There
people
no
are more in
perhaps, sir.
No,
in
there
the
are
system like you have in NHS. I remember a certain amount of money was kept as grant provided you had a certain number of publications. Your salary was linked to it. Here there is no incentive. Once you're a professor, you're a professor.
True. Nobody and people are in practice.
Yeah.
I think the worst thing is people practice and sometimes their motivation is very low.
Sir, I'm going to stop you at this point because I have an interesting question from Dr. Ram Prabhu, who is professor of surgical gastroenterology at KEM. He asks, Supe sir, any regrets of having allowed full-timers to start private practice and consequent teaching in medical college suffering? This is very important point. And Prabhu has raised that point, I think,
very right. But Prabhu, yes, I was the one who really advised everyone to start the practice, because at that time the full-timers needed money and everybody was, because you know, when I wanted to go and buy a house, the bank refused me loan, saying that your pay is only 11,000 and we can only give you 8 lakhs loan, and we cannot give, and that time the house costed 40 lakhs, you know, that is what the kind of a thing. So I realized that full-timers need some amount of money. So the model which was there, I remember that time when I was asked, I really said that, okay, we need a practice. So the practice people flourished, no doubt about that. But then there are very few who could keep up with the academics. And, you know, 85% maybe I feel flout some kind of academics and rules.
I think 99%.
No, there are people who do sincerely, I feel.
That 1%.
Yeah, but I personally feel ki, yes, they can really do practice as well as they can give their time in KEM more fruitfully. I think we can still do better kind of a thing. You know.
So coming on, continue the dean theme, you know, along with the dean job comes the baggage of politicians, committees, tenders, and I know for a fact that you are one of the cleanest persons I have met in my life. And I remember waking up one Sunday morning and finding your name on the front page of Mumbai Mirror in connection with some scam with the BMC, and I was horrified. I remember having called you at that time and having called the commissioner at that time, who was at that time very close to me. And I said, I would not trust my father, but I would trust Dr. Supe. And I simply cannot believe, I remember telling, I told you the name of the commissioner at that time also, that I cannot believe that he would be involved in this. So looking back, any regrets?
See, that was, somebody had hacked my account.
I know.
And then they had changed the account.
So, but the Mumbai Mirror had you on the front page. Yes. How do you think without ascertaining the facts?
Yes. But
this is the problem of high life. If you are sitting on the pedestal of dean, everybody is going to take a pot shot at you. And people have a lot of vested interests. You know that.
People wanted to pull you down because you always are there. But fortunately for me, that the same commissioner you are talking and everybody supported me so much. That they said, Dr. Supe, you don't have to do anything. In fact, all of them said that we are there to back you up. After 3 days, they promoted me to KEM and gave a message to everyone that there is nothing wrong.
Sir, was shifted from SIAM to KEM, which is considered a promotion.
In fact, I thought that news, I must thank them because that helped me to shift from SIAM to KEM. I look it from very positive way, I understand. But I like the way people reacted. I remember this whole Sion hospital, my colleagues, sisters, nurses, servants, all of them gathered. They burned the paper and everybody assured, and the message was very clear that no hanky-panky will do. And later on also this was proved that it was an hacking of my account and somebody done, and then it was all cleaned by that.
So is it true to say that the dean's post is like a crown of thorns?
Of course. Every day you get phone calls from about 200 people, out of that about 10-15 are politicians, MLAs, ministers, and they try to tell you sometimes things which you cannot do. And you have to very nicely tell them that this is not possible. And fortunately, I think initially I may have struggled, but later on I was very smooth in, I learned that art of saying no, and I think I survived very well. I think so. But at the end, I must tell you, all the politicians also had a very good relationship.
So much so that when sir retired as dean, I remember the then additional municipal commissioner, and I'll name her, Rijis Kundan, said, why don't you become OSD or PA or continue in BMC? Is that true, sir?
Yes,
they
true.
Wanted you to
oh, they wanted to make only 3 years.
Yes.
But I was,
sir.
Because you know, when you're in a system, and I think when you are of the system, everybody feels you are overpowering them. And they feel that you have taken their chance, their promotion. I don't think we should really have that feeling. And people say you have a vested interest. So I personally feel I was not keen on doing that.
I remember one, I'm spending time like this, sir. I must thank Alkem and Anoop Sharma for having given me this opportunity. The last time I spent an hour with sir was traveling back from Goa Medical College to Mumbai. Sir probably won't remember, he had come to the operation at the Goa State ASI meeting.
Yeah.
And I was giving a piddly lecture in some corner of the conference. And I traveled, but the best part of that was I got to travel back from Goa Medical College to airport, to Mumbai airport. And in that 2 hours, sir must have, he's been kind, he had 150 phone calls. And I could see that sir would get worked up getting those calls. And hearing how he had to patiently answer these calls from a variety of politicians, I was astonished how sir could handle that. Today he is looking so much younger and relaxed.
Oh my God.
That was 3-4 years ago.
Yes,
I'm
sure. Maybe. Yeah. No, it is a stressful job, dean's post, but it is something which gives you, it's a very different stature than when you are a surgeon and when you are a dean. Your public image and the way you can influence people is at a different level than when you are becoming this. So I would like to say that at some part of your career, ultimately, see, what is there in life? You have to give back to the society. If as a dean, if you are saying me, there are so many good things about dean post. Every year as a director, we used to do charity worth almost about 40 to 50 crores through our PBCF, through our donations. I think so many new things, so many poor patients, so many poor people we used to help, so many camps we used to do, so many activities we used to do. I think all that you can do simultaneously as a dean. So you leave away all these things which are sometimes 10 minutes or 15 minutes trouble in a day, but rest of the time you can always help in a constructive way. I think looking back all those 6 years, I personally feel I did much more good to the system, to the this, rather than sometimes. Sometimes I must have hurt people. You know, as an administrator, you can never be happy.
You are also too clean for people. That is part
of
the problem.
Yeah, exactly.
So, and sir had the unique distinction. I don't know, some of you would have seen when Sachin Tendulkar retired, he had a guard of honor given with all his teammates holding bats. In the history of KM, Dr. Avinash Suppe is the only dean who had a guard of honor given by medical student interns, residents, when he left KM. My son was part of that, so he showed me video footages of that. When sir walked out from his dean's cabin to his car, there was hundreds of students, residents, doctors, full-timers lining both corridors to bid him farewell. That is, like I said, priceless.
Yes.
Nothing can buy that.
I think I personally feel that is really priceless. That's the most important, I mean, one of the moments in my life which has really touched me. When I became a dean in KM, I think they welcomed me like that, and when I went as a retired as KM, they also welcomed. I think when you spend an institution so much of your life, I think the institution gives you back that kind of memories which you can take it throughout your life.
I mean, KM was like your first wife, madam was a stepwife. You spent so much time there.
Yeah, of course.
I'm sure you spent more time in KM than you did at home. So then
yes.
Suddenly when you retired from KM, you decided to go from being a poor man's surgeon to the rich man's surgeon. You went to Hinduja Healthcare in Khar, probably one of the most expensive hospitals in Mumbai, a boutique hospital. For those of you who don't know, sir is now executive director and head of Hinduja Healthcare in Khar, which is a boutique hospital in Khar, the Hinduja group, a different family, doing great work, but very high-end segment.
Yes.
So from you said you do something so much for poor people, and suddenly you move to a boutique hospital. How does that fit into your thinking?
Philosophy? No, I think I went only because of Dr. Bhale Rao. Dr. Bhale Rao came to me, my teacher, and he says, this hospital needs your help. And this hospital needs the way you need to set system. So you take, I said, sir, he said, at least take a contract for a few years. I told him. And I think he wanted to put those strategies there properly. And that's the reason he said, you come as a director, not as an executive officer. So I am a director there, so I guide them. I sometimes help them to run the show, but I agreed, it's a totally different way of looking at the hospital. It is a hospital where every day I get a celebrity from, you name it, and the celebrities are there. But, and it's a, of course, an expensive hospital.
So suddenly you are now focused on top line and bottom line as opposed to only patient care.
Yes.
Isn't that a change in thinking? There is the consequent marketing. I don't want to go into those details, which is a whole different ballgame.
No, but
what you've done for the whole of your life.
Yes, but I agree with you that. But one of the way I realize is that Hinduja has that way better culture. They have, they don't invest so much on marketing. They have their rules of whatever it is, and they are fairly ethical. So I personally feel I am able to survive. The day they start doing anything else, I'll leave that job.
Message is loud. You know, one of the failures, and I don't know if you call it a failure or not, and I was astonished at that time, was when you didn't get the vice chancellor job of the Maharashtra University of Health Sciences. For those of you who ever get a chance, please look at Sir CV. It's an amazing CV. Not only the publication, but right from the FAMR to the Illinois University teaching, you name it, it's there. And yet, you didn't get the VC job. And you said earlier that failures don't deter you, but this to me was astonishing. And clearly, I am telling you the reverse. When somebody in merit doesn't get it, how does it not hurt?
That yes.
You are not recognized what 20
No, it hurt me. Of course, it hurt me. But then immediately what my, they did, they made me director. Immediately, they gave me a director of medical education. So I think
that was BMC, sir. That
BMC.
Four hospitals. You could have shaped so much more. Looking back.
True, true. I think that was an opportunity lost.
Would you still apply, sir?
No, I won't apply now unless they offer me.
Anyway, will you not put sir into more controversial questions?
No.
Sir has been kind to answer that. Did you have any? Or do you still have challenges dealing with the kind of patients that you see in Hinduja Healthcare?
Yes, the kind of patients are very demanding patients, high-end patients. Yes, and they have wonderful feedback system. They have small things they fight for, and you know the kind of patients I saw. They were accepting patients. They were looking for therapy. they had no money, and here there is a every patient comes with loads of money and they want the finest kind of an smaller kind of an services they need. I think it's a challenge. I understand it's a different way to me to look at it.
It's like a hospitality industry, like a hotel. It is medical facility.
Yes.
I don't know, much smaller hospital than you. And I see that your healthcare is just one part of the.
True. There, hospitality is more, and the kind of surgeries. But one thing is that hospital needs to have more super specialties, and once they will have more super specialties, then the complexity of the surgery will probably change the culture of that hospital.
Let's change the tack of this discussion away from your current and look at sir has to me a unique work-life balance. I keep telling my fellows that a surgeon has three balls. He's like a juggler. One ball is your professional education and training and career. The second is your family life. And the third is your social commitment. When one ball goes very high in the air, inevitably the other two balls go lower. Looking back, sir, I know that you are a trekker, a photographer, you are a family man, you are a great surgeon. Do you think any of those balls didn't go as high as you wanted?
I probably have not planned, but it went off. Few of the things went very well. You know, the hobbies, let me tell you. Because of my full-timership, I could do a lot of hobbies. When I was young and very active, I could do trekking, Himalayan trekking, Alps trekking. I did in, latest I did in Antarctica and the South America trekking. But at the right age, I did trekking, Kailash Mansarovar and all. Once I thought that I am becoming now 35 plus, I shifted to wildlife photography. And thanks to my teachers, I shifted to photography as a profession. I went into photography of academic photography. We published almost 12 books with Bodhe sir, and aerial photography, exhibitions, then their talks, all that.
So you used to take a Piper aircraft and go to Kolhapur,
yeah,
along with your teacher Bodhe sir. And you actually did a lot of work photographing temples of Maharashtra. Tell
yes.
us about that. How was that experience?
Oh, I think it is something which I remember once we were discussing, and I told Bodhe sir that we have to improve the academics in photography. So then what we did, he got an opportunity to do aerial photography and from whole coast. So then we used this and we all forts, all the temples of Maharashtra, all the important places in the India. So we could have books on Andaman, we could have books on Lakshadweep, we have books on Maharashtra, Mumbai, Goa, then the ancient roots of this, then lighthouses, so many, and then all temples, Shegaon temple, Mahalakshmi temple, Siddhi Vinayak temple. And not only these books are landmark books, and along with that we did lot of work into how digital photography is, and then Photographic Society of India. And you know, I am very proud to say that I am an honorary member of Photographic Society of India, which is an unique, they'd give about one or two people every year. And that is something which I thought was, I enjoyed that photography all over the world, in fact, from say Antarctica to Australia to Tokyo to Kenya to Masai Mara, Tanzania, all these photographic tours. Very educational tools.
So let's take a short break and play a video by one of your close friends, Mr. Murali Krishna.
It gives me immense pleasure to talk about Dr. Avinash Subey. I, Murali Krishna, know Dr. Avinash Subey from 1992. We met as a student in a photography academy. Everybody knows him professionally, but few knows him personally. I am glad I am one of them. His love to nature is above limits. His commitment to his profession and humanity can't be described. To give an incidence, his mother was not doing very well and he knew that she will breathe her last in few hours, but he still had to fly for his pre-committed work. He softly told me, please take care here. Even after becoming one of the most successful doctor, he deals with everyone he meets with a lot of love and humbleness. He is one of the most down-to-earth person I have ever met in my life. He is a friend, philosopher and guide to me. And without saying, he is my elder brother. The new upcoming doctors have a lot to learn academically, but also morally and virtually from Dr. Avinash Suppe.
Great, wonderful sure. video from Mr.
Okay.
I'm now going to come on to your family. You have one daughter, Pranya, who is currently senior lecturer in a Sion hospital, who is a gynecologist. And you have a son-in-law, Vijesh Agarwal, who is a very well-known cardiologist. He works with us in Chembur. I had an opportunity to talk to them separately today. And I heard of the first meeting that Brijesh had with you. I don't know if he's told you this, but Brijesh and you met in Royal Orchid Hospital in Chembur Station.
Hotel, sorry. Yeah, yeah.
So, he was telling me, he was, you know, all the shaking, you know, this is a young boy who is Pranya senior, who came from a business family, and meeting the dean of the hospital.
Oh my God.
I was not a dean that time.
But I was HOD and HOD, that yes. time I was basically all this. But fortunately, normally I have habit of understanding people very clearly. I mean, I can talk to a 10 minutes or 5 minutes a person and I know what is likely to be his integrity. Sometimes, of course, as a, you know, as in working in KEM where you're seeing 200 patients every day and you're seeing all kinds of people. That is what we learn. So when I saw him first, I always realized that he is a person who is honest and he is a sincere person. So I think if Pranya likes him, there should not be any objection. There could be a lot of problems in the families. Means there are Agrawal, cultural differences. But I'm sure in a city like Mumbai, we can always adjust this. And we have learned to understand cultural sensitivity. You know, cross-cultural sensitivity was taught to me in FAMER. And they were told me that, okay, you're getting people from all over the world. Everybody has a different way of looking at it. So I accepted her decision and I respect her decision. And that's what
at this point, let's play Dr. Pranya Agarwal. That is Pranya Agarwal Ni Supe's video at this point.
Hi, I'm Dr. Pranya Suppe. I'm Dr. Avinash Suppe's daughter. What should I say about Baba? He's not only a great academician, a great teacher, a great surgeon, dean and director as well. There are so many aspects of his life that really everybody doesn't know about. He happens to be a very enthusiastic photographer, so much so that till he became the dean, he used to have a trip at least once a year for his photography. He has trekked almost all forts of Maharashtra, the Sahyadris, the Everest Base Camp and even Leh Ladakh. He is such, his enthusiasm in this extends so much that the first trip that he planned after retiring from the director's post was to go to Antarctica and the South Pole. He has immense love for Hindustani classical music. My entire childhood has grown listening to stalwarts like Rajan Sajjan Mishra and Pandit Jasraj because that was the only music that used to ever play in our house. He also is an avid Bollywood fan. Thanks to him, I have ended up seeing every Amitabh Bachchan and Dena Ravanan movies that exist. In spite of all his hobbies and his work, he still happens to be an out-and-out family man. When I was young, we used to have so many exclusive father-daughter trips. We used to go to places like Chowpatty and SL World, which I still fondly cherish. Also, he has been there for my every major event. He has dropped me for my every exam. Right from my 10th standard to my MBBS exams to even my PG exams. He has dropped me for my classes even if they have been as early as 7 a.m. So much so that I'm sure that a batch of residents of KEM Hospital must be really hating my classes because he used to end up going for rounds at 7:15 a.m. And he still continues to be an extremely indulgent grandfather. Whatever my daughter asks for, it is there, whether it's stationery stuff or even a new Samsung tab. He has taught my daughter so many things, how to play cards, how to use the various programs in a computer, so much so that even he ended up reading all her mythological Amar Chitra Kathas with her. And I just want to say what my granddaughter, when she wanted to write one sentence about her grandfather, she said, "My grandfather is an honest man." And I think that sums it all about the individual. Thank you.
Fantastic. I think Pradya is, you know, doing as well as you were in the early part of your career, sir. And Yudhish told me one statement that you had made at that time. I think you ended the dinner with him by saying that I trust Pradya and her morals. If she finds you good, then you must be good. So apart from you being, you made a very telling statement at that time. And I believe now you spend a lot of time with your two granddaughters. How
yes. Oh, one is 8 years, going to be 8 years in this month. Another is about two and a half years.
I can see the joy and
eyes. Nothing like that. Of course, I play with them. I play with them. My elder daughter, I teach her computers. I play cards. They sing very well. And it's a fun actually. I think these are the times you should not, maybe I did not give that much of time to Pradya, though I used to give to her, but you know, that time I was a lecturer, but now I think I can give definitely that time. Maybe that is one reason I took a job in Hinduja.
Yeah. So there's a question from Dr. Mohare, who is from the Department of Surgery at KM Hospital, and he asks you two questions. One is, what is your advice for young surgeons and how to be a good surgeon? I think the two questions are linked, so I'm going to ask you both these questions together, sir.
Fine. I think it's an important lesson I have learned in my life from many surgeons. The first is, I think you have to be a safe surgeon. You may not do extraordinary surgery at times, but you have to be a safe surgeon. And the success to a safe surgeon is, you must plan your surgery before you take knife in your hand. I think that's what Professor Blumgart taught me. That the most important part of the surgeon is brain and not hand. Many people really run after the skills and technology, which is important, but what is important also is your brain, the way you plan it. And along with that, you have to have calm temperament, compassionateness, good communication skills, understanding of your patients. And if you work in a team, you know, I personally feel today is a day where everybody should respect each other in your team. Take help of people if you need it. You can't do everything alone. And lastly, but not the least, is control your surgical ego. Right. I personally feel that in the young days, I may put hands and I may take out tumors without realizing sometimes that in my that surgical ego, I may cause little damage to the patient. So that maturity helps you to really be safe surgeon. So I would now give more importance to the planned surgeon, safe surgeon, compassionate surgeon. That's the way to become a good surgeon.
So I think Dr. Shrikhande had made one statement during his interview with me, and he said a safe surgeon knows his way down the mountain. And that's so true. What you're saying is, when you have young heart and you think you've got it all, you know it all, you can take out any tumor anywhere, then you get some grey hair, or in some case no hair, and then you realize that, you know, you can't.
True, very true, very true. You should know when to come out, when to stop. I think sometimes, you know, in a patient, my lecturer is all the time saying, sir, explore her, explore her. You put your hand and you say, okay, let's wait for a day, and I see the next day patient is normal. You feel so happy that you did not explore on this.
So if I were to ask you at this point is, having heard so much and you had such a star-studded career, what is left for you to achieve?
I think we have been taught by our family, by our teachers, that to give back to society, how much you can give back. You know, as
but
I said,
you work for KM, you did so much of work in surgery in KM.
Yeah, but
if you think, what is left for you to achieve?
Oh, we can, whatever in my life, I can continue to work, whether in a private sector, public setup, social setup. My education is my still big career, which I continue to do. I'm trying to change the whole curriculum of the country now, along with my expert group. No, I'm the advisory group. Okay, I'm not the part of that, but I am their expert group member. We are trying to change the curriculum. We are helping the country to change over. That's major kind of an, I feel, contribution. And I feel if you are able to change some competence of the surgeons and the students, I think we can really make our country, I'm saying, self-sufficient in the health. I think that is what we want to really do.
And if I were to ask you candidly, what are your regrets in life? What would you have done differently, given a chance to rewrite this pain book?
Okay. I would have definitely continued to be in KEM. Uh-huh. No doubt about that.
As a dean or as a HOD?
HOD, I had a fulfilling career. I would have continued as a HOD also, and I would have treated more patients. But I would have definitely tried to improve outreach programs. That's what I feel, which I did in the initial part of my life. But later on, I think I could not do it going into smaller places, training more people, teaching more people, teaching more patients, I mean, treating more patients. That I think we can still do more.
Do you believe in destiny?
Yes.
And God?
Yes.
You think you've been guided towards your time in life to Hinduja, having left deanship?
No, I think I'm little rational from like Dr. Bapat. I believe in him. Like he classically used to say, there are three kinds of people. Those who believe in Andhashraddha. There are some people who are Ashraddha. But I am not too. I am Sashraddha. I have faith in some people. I believe in those people. And I personally feel if you are doing good, things will sometime come in your way. Sometimes you may have little to back out. But if you have some faith in somebody, I think you will do. I am not a Andhashraddha. I will not do anything for somebody. I am a rational.
But somebody as a human or God?
As a human only, I feel. More of a human.
Not a puja and that kind of person?
Not too much.
So is the Brahma Vidya rubbing off on you, sir?
Not really. I remember I went to Kailash Mansarovar, but I went it as a more of a trekker rather than the yatra.
Spiritual.
I went to practically every place in the India, which is really like, from Kailash Mansarovar to All Char Dham, I went to even the this Vatican, and I went to big churches. But I have always gone as a rationalist.
If I were a young surgeon just finished MS who wanted to start off in life, what advice would you give me?
I would tell him that you first spend some time into public system, understand the crux of the people, but at the same time see that what you are learning. If you are not learning much, don't stay in that system. It's time to come out of that system if you are not learning. Try to go for specialized skills and focus yourself and go into one or two of your special kind of areas where you are the master. Ultimately, it's like if tomorrow, if you know I'm working on corrosives, I'm working on say ODS, I'm working on say GERD, then I should be the master of that. I think that matters more rather than trying to do all kinds of surgeries. Because after some time in your life, you don't only require money. You require little amount of respect. You require fame. You require people to really come to you. You know, today some patient from all over the India, some patient comes to you and says that, okay, Roy is the best surgeon for GERD or ODS. You know, it's a different feeling rather than 100 patients coming and getting you one surgery.
So, peer approval, ladies and gentlemen, I think that message and theme is very, very clear in SIRS things. So, pick up an area of specialization, spend your time, money, energy on that, and excel in what you do. Sir, another interesting question, and this is again going to put you on a spot. This is from Dr. Ashish Tawde, who is a practicing surgeon in Mumbai. Dr. Ashish asks you, how did Dr. Supe overcome competition from not so competent surgeons who excelled?
I understand. See, when you are in a system which a public system with so much of cultural, financial, then political pull, there really happens that sometimes people who are less competent than you or not so thing go across you and they go ahead with you. Okay. There are people who, I remember a classic story of one of my classmates, you know, he excelled in the whole class, he got maximum marks, but nowhere he got gold medal. Because all the honoraries or somebody's sons got gold medal at that time.
So in our time, that was that so time. Common.
Yes.
It was a theory and practical.
Yes. Time. But then, if you look at back now, after 20 years, his career is one of the topmost career. And those people who did not get gold medals that time got the best careers. And those who probably got because of influence, their careers are now nowhere.
So young ladies and gentlemen watching this, life is the big leveler. You may get that extra push from your parents being who's who, but eventually the person who's...
You have to show your own metal. And see, the system and the whole public looks for your own metal. The way you speak, what are your results, the way you deliver, ultimately matters. Everything, rest of the thing can be a short time or a part-time supporter. Long term, you have to show your mettle. I think that is the message you have to really take.
Absolutely fabulous. So the question from Dr. S. Prabhakar, who is the head of Department of Surgery at LTMGH in Siam Hospital. And Dr. Prabhakar asks, sir, if I were to ask you, who is your greatest single person, who is your greatest inspiration in life? I know it's a difficult question for you to answer.
But yeah, I had many, but I can tell you two or three of my teachers, like Dr. Samsi and Dr. Bapat, really influenced me. And not only in the surgical life, also, I mean, if you say Dr. Mathur also, they influenced me in my career, not as an only surgeon, but also as a human being. The way their principles, the way I think the hobbies, the way you treat people, way you maintain networking, relationship, all of them definitely have influenced you for that.
And probably the last question, as I say, it's been 1.5 hours, it's been amazing time, and I think God has been kind, he's given me the opportunity to spend time with you. How would you like to be remembered as? 20 years down the line, in ASICON or a MASICON, how would you think you would be like to be remembered as?
I would like to remember as a surgeon who promoted the GI and HPB surgery in the country, as well as who trained as a surgical, who really gave so much as a surgical educator and developed a lot of surgeons who have done a lot of good to the society.
Ladies and gentlemen, you will agree that this has been one of the most fascinating insights into this great man's personality, and I'm truly privileged to be given the opportunity to interview, sir. I want to thank
you so much,
Mr. Joshi,
thank you so much,
Mr. Anup from Alchem Version Nova, for making this possible. And I hope that all the youngsters in the country who are listening and watching this interview will have as much inspiration from sir as I have had consistently throughout my life. Sir, you are truly my role model. I really appreciate all the teaching, wisdom and guidance, and I hope you will continue to do this in years to come.
Sure.
God bless you, sir.
Thank you so much.
Sir, as a parting last request to you, may I request you to give me 10 of your best photographs, whichever, the temples, the forts, the Antarctica, and I'm going to play them at the end of this interview, just for all of us to have memories of you back.
Definitely.
Thank you, sir.
Definitely, I'll do that.
Thank you, sir.